Good morning, everyone, and thank you all for your time and attention to a very important topic discussing California housing issues in a very, very difficult and challenging time. We are very fortunate today to have our fearless leader, Janet Murguía. Did I say that correctly? My apologies, I've only been a month on the job.
Close enough.
All right, Murguía. And very lucky to have her here today to give us some opening remarks, as well as maybe some aspiration and some vision for what we have in store, given everything that she's doing at the moment. And with no further ado, Janet, please take it away.
Hey, Jose, thank you so much. Hello, everyone. Really appreciate so many of you taking the time to join us for this important discussion. I know we have had a series of them planned on this important topic. I know focusing generally on housing, but I know we all are understanding what's underneath all of these needs right now. And so it's good afternoon from Washington, D.C. That's where I've been in the last few weeks since we've been sheltered in place. So I just want to begin by thanking, again, all of you for participating, for thanking our panelists in this particular session. I know we had already two leaders, Secretary Castro Ramirez and Director Velasquez, who took time to speak with our affiliate partners about California's plans to address the housing challenges in the state, especially as these challenges are impacted by the current pandemic. And again, thanks to our three affiliate partners who will be giving you the updates from different parts of the state on how this pandemic is affecting our Latino communities and their operational capacity as affiliates. So I'm grateful to them and to all of you all in the state who really stepped up to help our communities and families stay in their homes, stay protected and healthy, and keep food on the table. I know a lot of you have adapted your missions to respond to the moment, and we're so grateful. It's also why at UnidosUS, we've established the Esperanza Hope Fund to help our affiliates get through this emergency and help sustain many of you for the future work that needs to be done. I know we want to do more. We've had a series of grants we've been able to put out, but we're really working hard to raise more funds so that we can be more helpful. And I could appreciate that you, as California-based affiliates, face the task of addressing housing challenges that existed well before the pandemic hit, right? We could have had this conversation even before the pandemic because, you know, we understand that many of our families have been struggling to make mortgage or rent payments. And now that's only been exacerbated with the pandemic. In many parts of the country, including just blocks from where I am right now, I think it's important for us to connect that what we are seeing, you know, in terms of the biggest civil uprising in our nation in decades, to connect it to what you all are experiencing even as we look at the housing lens. What prompted these protests, and rightly so, was the tragic, inhumane, and senseless murder of George Floyd and too many others at the hands of law enforcement. UnidosUS is standing with our brothers and sisters in the Black community and the African-American community in calling for justice and for accountability for law enforcement and the highest levels of government. But what we know that is also spurring these protests is what has yet to be fully addressed and resolved by our nation: systemic racism and systemic inequality. And it's not just about the criminal justice system or police enforcement. We see it in every aspect of the lives of the people that we serve. You know, it's not a coincidence that the pandemic has disproportionately harmed African Americans and Latinos. It's about the longstanding inequities in health and access to care and housing. It's not a coincidence that the unemployment rate for Latinos and African Americans is now nearly 20% when it's only half of that for whites. It's about decades of wage and job discrimination and educational inequities. And it's also not a coincidence that in recent polls, 2/3 of Latinos are worried about not being able to pay the rent or mortgage. It's about housing discrimination and inequality as a way of life for communities of color. You know, while I do not condone the violence, I understand deeply the frustration and the anger that's playing out. You know, we've let these systemic inequalities fester for far too long, and they still aren't even at the top of mind for many of our elected officials. And just look at the relief packages enacted so far by Congress that have prioritized assistance for major industries mm-hmm. over help for those on the front lines or who have been left unemployed by the crisis. Many who are our community, our gente who are in those essential jobs, being exposed at a higher level and more vulnerable because of the inherent vulnerable health issues that we have, the chronic health issues that we have. So many in the Latino community, and you all know this firsthand, haven't received any relief that we've seen as a result of these stimulus packages. According to our poll, 1/3 of U.S.-born Latinos and 45% of Latino immigrants said they didn't get a stimulus check, and more than half reported getting no break on their April, May, or June rent or mortgage payments. Among Latino small business owners, basically 50% reported having difficulty accessing small business loans. And that's why we continue to urge members of Congress to address the needs of Latinos who are essential workers and deserve protection from sickness and the economic effects of this pandemic, and to help mitigate the impact the systemic inequality and the impact that that has had on the effects of this crisis in our community. So we are urging our community and you all and our allies to communicate with their senators this week about the importance of a relief bill that includes what was passed by the House, the HEROES Act, and provisions such as cash payments to tax-paying families, including mixed-status families and emergency rental assistance, as well as expanded health care for the uninsured. We've made a point to actually fight for that language in the House passed bills, and we did succeed. There's no guarantee, though, that the Senate will do the same, and they haven't even yet taken up a bill. So we need to make sure we're weighing in on behalf of that assistance. So I know that today's convening will focus on the effects of the economic downturn this pandemic has had on existing housing challenges in California, and how we can work together to identify solutions to meet the housing needs of Latino in the state, of every Latino in the state. But we look to California for your leadership. And we hope that this conversation will produce some, you know, real solutions, clear ideas about how we can move forward together. I really appreciate your time, your energy every day, and your voice on behalf of our community, but especially today for convening to help us come together to really identify the best solutions so we can move forward. I'm going to turn it back over to one of my newest employees, Jose Carmona, who's doing a great job out there in California. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Janet. Your national leadership is extremely appreciated. We are tremendously grateful for your tireless advocacy on behalf of Latinos across the country and, of course, you know, the great golden state of California. Thank you very much for your time. Good morning, everyone. As Janet noted, I am the newest team member to UnidosUS as the new policy advisor here in California, and I will be moderating the next portion of the program. I have been just with UnidosUS a little bit over a month, but I have been in and out of the Sacramento policy advocacy community for about 18 and 19 years, so I'm extremely excited to be part of the team and to be working with all of you, and I look forward to meeting all of you very soon. We will be conducting three panelists, and before we get them on the virtual stage, want to just do a couple housekeeping items. So what staff will be doing is collecting questions from the Q&A box. So if any of our affiliate members have any questions, please submit them, and we will be evaluating and identifying two to three to ask to all three panelists after they conclude. That way we provide ample time for each one to do their presentation and ideally give you enough content by which to think about the type of question you might want to communicate. So please don't hesitate, don't be shy, ask those questions. So as I noted, we're delighted to have three leaders fighting for housing policies to help low-income communities. We have Alicia Matricardi with New Economics for Women, Norma Garcia with the Mission Economic Development Agency, and we have Tom Collishaw with Self-Help Enterprises, all doing tremendous work in a very, very difficult and challenging time. But we'd like to start with Alicia Matricardi, who is the General Counsel and Director of Real Estate for New Economics for Women. New Economics for Women is a nonprofit that has been in operation for 30 years, building affordable housing and looking at how to move families into economic stability. Alicia, take it away.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be with you all. Good morning. As a developer, as an economic services provider, we wear many hats. I'll take you to our first slide that will show us our mission and vision. We build affordable housing. We offer programs and services. Most importantly, our vision is to empower generations of Latinas and their families to thrive. We like to say that we help to move families up the economic ladder, but we do cover all rings on that ladder. So I'll walk us through a little bit of what our response to COVID-19 has been thus far, which is ever-changing by the day. But I hope that it has some resonance to you, our partners and affiliates throughout the state. So I mentioned that we wear a lot of different hats. I'll start with the experience as a developer, as a landlord, and then our experience as a rental housing advocate, our experience at the ground level, really with our most vulnerable populations, our experience seeking to develop homeowners, and our experience working with women business clients, those who have businesses that we seek to replicate and thrive. So our experience as a developer, you know, as a director of real estate, I'm not seeing any slowing in any of our deals, which is really interesting. So the next slide that is up now is a signing of one of the closings that we've had recently. Let me skip to that while the slide is up. Our homeownership experience is thriving. Since the beginning of the pandemic really coming to fruition in our streets, right, in March, we've seen 9 closings for homeowners purchasing in the low to moderate affordability markets, basically up to 120% of area median income. How incredible that families still have the ability to close. Some of those were deals that were in the pipeline, but we're not seeing any slowings there. What we are seeing is the potential for homeowners who are in a mortgage crisis to be steered into refi experiences and other products instead of a refi experience or a mortgage forbearance. So a lot of education has to be done with those homeowners. We're really trying to be conscientious as we look at foreclosure prevention. What do our families need? What are the products that are out there? How do we help them sift through products? So we almost have to do a secondary homeownership counseling piece. Of course, we're familiar with foreclosure prevention. That is a secondary education piece, but we're seeing that need, that tremendous need to make sure that our families remain stable and are not jeopardized as homeowners as we move forward. Let's go to the next slide. I think it's another closing. Closings have changed in the real estate development world. We're seeing that as a developer. We're seeing that as a housing advocate. But they're still happening. I think in the future, we're going to have to rethink notarization of documents post-COVID. Closings like this might not have to happen where we all meet in person. A lot of DocuSign, right? So nothing unfamiliar, I'm sure, to all of our partners in the field. So those are the only slides I have. I want to walk through some of our other responses as a community development organization. As an owner, as a property manager, our response is for the first time, probably in incredible alignment with our response as a tenant advocate group, right? So wearing those two hats, I've never seen more alignment on the messaging. And the messaging that we have learned to be able to put out is that there's a lot of misinformation going on as to what some of the remedies are for tenants. And as a landlord, it becomes our duty, our responsibility to make sure that tenants have information so that they know what's available to them. We have rental moratoriums going on, and that's, you know, at the city, at the county, at the state level, moratoriums on evictions. But we're finding a lot of misinformation about when rents are due, and it's creating crisis within families. So I'm very proud to see the alignment for us as landlords and for us as tenant advocates in that respect, because the clarity of the information is the best that we can do. A lot of fear and instability around those who have DACA recipients in the household, those that are undocumented. And for us, that means the trust factor has never been more important. And our ability to be advocates and to receive the information is very important. So that intimate dialogue needs to be replicated. We're seeing that the need for that and its importance has never been higher. And we see that as an ancillary aspect of our response to COVID. As a safety net program provider, we are seeing that this has caused a lot of women to be displaced from their jobs in the amount of number that, of course, we've never seen before. But what will that mean for us in the future? And our reflections on that are, of course, still developing. But it is likely to mean that we're going to need a big kind of policy stimulus, something that will help to retrain for these workers, because we don't know that their jobs will ever be there again. In terms of factory employment and, you know, particularly women in sewing trades. We're seeing a lot of women who are former childcare workers without an opportunity to return to their work. So we're particularly seeing the impacts among Latinas day to day. We are a safety net service provider contracted out of the city of LA to distribute what are called locally the Angelino cards. Which are basically check cards that can buy emergency food and supplies. We've distributed over $1 million worth of those cards in our contracts with localities, but we're really seeing the need for this, you know, unrestricted ability to get food on the table for these families. And that advocacy position, you know, it's always been very difficult to say we need an unrestricted supply of money. No, it has to be payment directly to the renter. It has to be directly for food. You know, a lot of the federal benefit programs work that way. But what we're seeing now is families have no safety net and are underserved by housing and really a growing in desperation as federal stimulus checks are not available. And so the resource development and the use of that unrestricted stimulus has never been more important. And as a distributor, you know, even us working through how do we sign people up, how do we do that level of contact while also practicing social distancing has been an incredible challenge for us to meet in the moment. I mentioned our Women's Business Center programs as well. What we're finding there are four real takeaways as a developer to try to find a safety net there. The banking vocabulary is an extraordinary challenge for those that are receiving any kind of PPP loan. So a lot of education needs to go into how you read those documents and what the banking vocabulary is. There's no unified channel for information. I mean, how true is that right now, right? In the past week that we can't identify very clearly where the protest is, right? Or who is protesting. We find that because of COVID, those that are seeking information as to how to operate their businesses or where to go cannot find any clear information. Federal websites have not served our community very well in that regard at all. So we have to step in to be the intermediary. People think that they're getting a loan and PPP is not that. I think for loans under $150,000, so there's an education piece there because you know, many think that they're planning for payments for repayment and they really don't have to do that. So that's remains a challenge. And the pivot here, the takeaway from the business centers is the innovation that has come out at this point in time. For our fashion clients, we're finding that they've retooled their ability to sew and are certainly doing masks and PPE. We found a lot of those women who were never entrepreneurs before are finding themselves really well suited for entrepreneurial positions. So how do we turn someone who was previously so familiar with working in an environment where they were not the boss into the boss with the confidence and the vocabulary and the business setting that they need to be able to thrive? That's a really exciting pivot that we're seeing throughout Los Angeles, and the fashion industry seems to be the most prevalent there in terms of the referrals that we're getting. But the housing instability continues. There is no challenge like that in any other state that I'm aware of, certainly in our area, that exacerbates the need for us to stay very clearly focused on the prevention of housing insecurity. So how do we act as tenant advocates and how do we literally build more affordable housing at this time? I know on Friday we'll be looking at another panel that will deal with what are some of the policy recommendations for the creation of housing during this time, but I'd be remiss if I don't mention that the state needs something like another neighborhood stabilization program. And that came out of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. About, I want to say, 10 years prior, right, under the Obama administration. We need that replicability of a program. We need that program in California so that we can really attack the fundamental lack of housing resources for us to close on these deals. And my second point, just to wrap up, we need institutions to get out of the way, quite frankly. We have a lot of red tape obstacles that need to be well thought through. And as we're dealing with housing instability and an affordable housing crisis, we have to think as though our hair were on fire, because this is amounting to children and families living in cars, not just in the streets, but working families that have no place to go. And so this is in and of itself a pandemic. Looking at housing as a right and as a mobilizing factor towards healthcare and economic stability. So we really need for cities, municipalities, counties to all get in this fight with us. And that means really removing some of the obstacles to the development of affordable housing through streamlining the development process. So not only do we need the housing resources, but we need for our localities to recognize what obstacles they put in the way to develop affordable housing and we need to be bold enough to recognize that the development of affordable housing should take priority over any other market rate housing. And to the extent that market rate develops affordable, the affordable housing has to be kind of a green lighted in a way that will bring these units to market quicker than a 3 to 5 year turnaround here in Los Angeles, which is, you know, it's absolutely obscene and unworkable. So I hope that adds some context in terms of our COVID response and what we're looking at. And I look forward to hearing Tom and Norma's presentations and taking any questions.
Great. Well, your work is definitely appreciated, Alicia, specifically your focus on women, given their vulnerability in society and the role they play not only in the household, but in our economy. So thank you for your tireless work.
Thank you.
And the point you made about streamlining, I know there's a Senate package that just came out a couple of weeks ago, so it'd be great to get your thoughts on that maybe down the road. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. We now move on to Norma Garcia, Director of Policy and Advocacy for MEDA, Mission Economic Development Agency. She leads the organization's efforts to secure laws and policies that promote economic and social justice for MEDA's clients and community. Norma, take it away.
Great. Thank you so much for having us here today. And it's an honor and a pleasure to be in the company of all the panelists and everyone who's joined us here today through UnidosUS. Just a quick synopsis of MEDA's mission. We are rooted in San Francisco's Mission District. We're focused on San Francisco, but our impact is statewide and national. And our mission is to strengthen low and moderate income Latino families by promoting economic equity and social justice. We do that through asset building, community development, and policy advocacy to ensure that the policies are in place so that we can move our mission forward for our community. Next slide, please. Okay, so we were asked to provide some community observations about what we have seen with respect to COVID-19 and how it's impacted our community. And I thought before getting into that, I wanted to set the context so that we have a better understanding of the situation in which we find ourselves in San Francisco's Mission District. So the city of San Francisco has a current population of nearly 900,000 people. It's much smaller than Los Angeles, to be sure. The Latino population overall is 15%. In San Francisco's Mission District, which has been a traditional hub for the Latino community for generations, the Latino population is around 42%. But what's notable is that in a 10-year period, between 2000 and 2010, and a few years later, approximately 8,000 Latinos were displaced from San Francisco's Mission District due to gentrification. As you know, with the growth of Silicon Valley and the locus of San Francisco as a tech hub, that brought a lot of higher wage workers to San Francisco. The Mission District is geographically located close to freeway entrances that serve the South Bay tech companies. It's also a place where shuttle buses run for the tech industry. And so it's become a very popular neighborhood. It started out as an affordable-ish neighborhood for the newcomers. But what has happened is that's really driven up rent. So let's go to the next slide. Okay. So the context is the San Francisco's Mission District, we exist under extreme gentrification pressures. There has been, as I said, a great displacement wave. And we are working very closely with a number of community partners to create a strong equity ecosystem within our neighborhood and surrounding neighborhoods in San Francisco. And so that means working closely together. And if you know, we're a direct service organization. We serve approximately 8,000 community members a year in a variety of free services. We're also a housing developer and have over, I think it's 1,200 units plus in our portfolio. That's a combination of preserved affordable housing and also new affordable housing. We are building at the moment, thankfully this has not stopped. A couple of our projects are getting closer to completion, and between those two, they will add approximately 240 new affordable housing units, 100% affordable housing to San Francisco's Mission District. But in the meantime, we're dealing with COVID-19. And so for me, a very key date is March 16th. On March 16th, Meta began remote operations. Just a couple days before, the city of San Francisco went into a shelter-in-place mode by order of the mayor and the Department of Public Health. And as you can imagine, as many of you probably experienced, that it was extremely disruptive because our way of delivering service is face-to-face client contact. Suddenly that was cut off, but our clients' needs did not end. And so the way we stayed connected to our clients initially was to call them and to check on their well-being and to let them know that we're still here to serve them. And in that process, our staff were asking the clients that we serve, what are your greatest needs? And overwhelmingly, people said they were worried about having food to feed their family. They were worried about that next bag of groceries. How am I going to feed my family? The other issue that came up, without exception, people were worried about losing their housing. And what does it mean to lose your housing in the middle of a pandemic when you're ordered to shelter in place? You know, what does it mean for the long run when your community is what holds you and you have to leave that community if you can't afford to pay? So that was another issue. Income replacement. People were wondering, oh my goodness, I've lost my job or my hours have been cut. What am I going to do to be able to replace that income? How am I going to do that? So those three issues really rose to the top. And next slide, please. So in this process, we learned that there were other issues too. Remote learning was a big issue that our community identified for us. Our children were now learning at home. And we learned that many of our families did not have the equipment so that their children could continue their lessons remotely through the school district. We also learned that there were issues around digital literacy that even if they did have the equipment, impeded their ability to fully utilize the equipment in a way to advance their children's education. We also found that to be an impediment for our community members that we were counseling through obtaining their benefits online. You know, that was another stumbling block. And so a lot of our work was over the telephone. What would have taken us maybe 20 minutes in person turned into an hour and a half discussion. And the impact for our clients and our staff, as you can imagine, has been significant as a result. So our strategy was to focus in on what Meta does best and to continue to work closely with our partners. And we focused our mission on serving issues around income and income replacement, securing housing, and protecting our small businesses. Because in San Francisco's Mission District, the Mission Street corridor is our economic backbone. And many of our small businesses operate on this corridor, right off the corridor, and they provide many community services to our neighbors, which keep people in the neighborhood. They're serving our community. So it didn't take long for us to realize that with COVID-19, we were witnessing income, racial, and all forms of social inequality on steroids at the intersection of an unprecedented health crisis. And that was incredibly jarring. But to illustrate a point of how all those things came together, I want to share with you a very important study that took place in San Francisco in late April in the Mission District. We partnered with UCSF and the San Francisco Department of Public Health and community groups to conduct a study of infection in the Mission District. So what we learned is that existing socioeconomic inequities were major factors in determining who got sick in the Mission District. So let's look at the next slide. Oh, okay, go back. It's not mine. I'll talk through this. Okay, so here's what we found out. In early April, not long after San Francisco entered into shelter in place, we learned that the first 103 people admitted to San Francisco General Hospital for the disease, more than 80% were Latino. And this testing that happened over 4 days revealed that Latinos accounted for 44% of all the individuals tested, but 95% of those who tested positive. Among those who tested positive, most reported they were unable to work from home. Most reported that they were having a negative impact on their income, And of those who were able to work from home, they reported no negative income issues. Nearly 89% of all those who tested positive earn less than $50,000 a year. Those are our clients. They live in households of 3 to 5 and many larger households. And so what we knew is that the pre-existing conditions of inequity that expose our community members to greater risk are what are causing high numbers of outbreaks for COVID-19. So as Janet mentioned earlier, we shouldn't be surprised with these outcomes. But what is surprising to me is that while a medical model has been used to identify vulnerable communities at the onset of the pandemic, no one was saying that income inequality is a driver of vulnerability. And so one of the things we're doing is trying to drive a new definition, a new evaluation of how you determine vulnerability on the front end to demand prophylactic protections for the community on the front end and additional resources on the back end. And so what we're working on next, given that our focuses are on income, housing, and small businesses, there's one thing I want to point to that I think is really helpful. And I know that we're all talking about a lack of resources for our community, and it's something that we're all working to bring to our communities. But I wanted to tell you about a really great thing that happened. Oh, I hear my time's up. I'll make it quick. A really great thing that happened was the Mission Family Relief Fund. An anonymous donor donated $100,000 for Meta to donate to families in need. And we were able to give 1,000 cash grants to 100 families within the span of a week and a half. And what we know from a survey of these recipients is that 3/4 of the families used the funds to pay for rent and food. Half of all the families used all of their relief funds within a week, which tells us that there's a widespread urgency for financial support, and that continues. And nearly all families reported additional needs beyond what the relief fund covered. And 1/2 of families were still not able to pay all their rent. So what we know, and we're going to talk about this in the panel a little bit later, is that inability to pay rent means a greater susceptibility to eviction. Greater susceptibility to eviction creates more opportunities for gentrification. More opportunities for gentrification creates a situation where our communities start to disappear. So we're working on housing, we're working on fortifying our small businesses, and working closely with our partners in many different ways that I don't have time to go into, but I encourage you to take a look at Meta's website, metasf.org, for some details and resources, and to check out our Facebook page, because we have also done a number of Facebook Live sessions on issues related to COVID-19 and Latinos, and they're in Spanish. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Norma. And thank you for holding it down in one of the most important cultural Latino communities in California, given the mission and all the beauty and art and people that it reflects. Thank you for all your tireless work. Last but not least, we have Tom Collishaw, the president and CEO of Self Help Enterprises, a nationally recognized community development organization whose mission is to work together with low-income families to build and sustain healthy homes and communities. Since 1965, Self-Help Enterprises efforts have touched the lives of over 55,000 families. Tom, all you, brother.
Thank you, Jose. And thank you for everybody for being here today to talk about this critical topic. We do focus on housing, both single family ownership housing, associated home buyer education and counseling, which we do closely with UnidosUS. And we also do affordable rental housing development. But beyond that, we also work in many of the smallest rural communities of the San Joaquin Valley on infrastructure needs, including clean water and water capacity and water quality. And they're all intertwined in our work. Probably the best thing, you can go to slide 2. We're still known most probably for our self-help housing program. And that's where families, largely Latino families and farm worker families, build their own homes using a substantial sweat equity. They build with their neighbors, build 10 homes at a time. Nobody moves in until all those homes are done. So there's a real shared labor concept. over 6,300 families have done this program. And I'm pleased to say that even during COVID-19, as you see here, folks are still doing that program and moving into homes. So that's a good piece of news. Just like Alicia and Norma mentioned, we're still building, and we're still building significantly on the affordable rental housing side as well. What we have seen, you could go to the third slide. One of the things that we've seen during the pandemic, you know, we had a housing crisis before the pandemic hit, and the situation has just been exacerbated. We already had most of the families that we work with come to us, and they're paying more than 50% of their income on housing, and that's only increased. We've seen unemployment increase just like it has everywhere. We do work in a part of California that routinely has an unemployment rate that's twice, at least two times, and often three times as high as the state average, and that's no different during the pandemic. Our portfolio of rental housing, we have currently about 1,700 units. About a quarter of those are reserved specifically for farm workers who are largely Latino. And the balance are for low-income working and other families. We know that about two-thirds of our portfolio are, the residents are farm workers. It's just that many of those are undocumented farm workers. And we're doing remarkably well through March and April on collecting rents. But what I've described is that we, you know, what normally takes us a week to collect has taken 4 weeks to collect in those 2 months. And we expect that to continue to be a struggle for families and our residents. And what that means is we have really responsible families who are making sure they pay their rent, because we know that they're struggling with other expenses. People clearly need cash for food. They need money to help them pay their rent. They need or mortgage, utility bills, healthcare. And we are most concerned about our undocumented families because of public charge rules. We entered the pandemic where they were wary of approaching public sources of funding, and that's again even worse during the pandemic. So the programs that are available out there, trying to get people to connect to them, has been a challenge because of concerns over this administration's treatment of those who are undocumented. We've seen food lines and the frequency of food giveaway programs doubled or tripled. The picture here is our resident services staff, who we've had to cease some of the resident services on our rental complexes just because of the pandemic, have morphed into this unbelievable team that is doing food deliveries, doing bottled water deliveries, and those kinds of things. So we have seen it exacerbated in our rural communities, the need for basic necessities like water. You can go to the next slide, please. So our immediate housing challenges, and that's a picture of a recently opened affordable rental housing community in Dinuba, Tulare County. We know that each month that this pandemic continues, where there's been disruptions in people's incomes and daily lives, we know that's getting tougher and tougher for people to pay their bills. It's also, including the rent, it's also important, as somebody who's a survivor of the last recession, that affordable housing providers cannot be, we've got to make sure that they're going to be made whole when we get through all of this. All of us are working closely to do payment plans and those kinds of things with our residents. But over time, there are going to be affordable housing providers that start to struggle financially. So that's going to be a real need. We're also seeing with our single family ownership programs, while we're continuing there, it has been a struggle on some levels to continue that work. Just the art of construction is tough because you can't put people in units with subcontractors, and you can't have two subcontractors at one time. So we're seeing some slowdowns. But the biggest concerns that we have about affordable housing and continuing to develop, particularly on the rental side, is that there are a real disruption in the market for low-income housing tax credits, which we rely on as really the cornerstone of most of our rental housing development. The market for tax credits we know firsthand because we have two deals we're trying to get financed by investors right now, that we've probably in the 12 to 15% range that they're paying less for the tax credits. So that's a big problem going forward. We're also concerned about real estate values. You know, there's going to be some fallout just because of what's going on in the economy. How has our organization shifted in recent months? One of the things that we're seeing is that we have a counseling team that traditionally counsels people into home ownership and does home buyer education and financial counseling. They have become crisis financial counselors, and we've had to pivot to making sure that people are being connected with what resources are out there to be able to assist them. And that's been a significant change. We're also raising money for direct assistance. Norma just mentioned the fund that they put together, and that's very impressive. We're doing the same thing. We found that it's pretty easy to raise money, but we also have to learn how to give out money. and so we're working our way through that, and assessing and doing the triage that's around who needs the money for what. So that's a capacity thing for us. Is we're going to be we're operating a pandemic crisis fund right now. We have expanded our virtual capabilities, but all of our we too often do things one-on-one, and so we've had to shift how all that's done. And I think we've lost some in the process, but we're building other capacities in the process. And resident service provision has been a tough one for us because we've tried to keep an after-school program staff at least financially whole through the pandemic, because those people are critical on our rental housing sites because they do after-school programs with kids, which we actually can't do at the moment. So we see going forward, daycare for the families we work with is a huge challenge right now. We were pleased that farm workers, it took a pandemic for us to, for the world to understand what we've known about farm workers for our lives, which is that they are essential workers. And so we need to make sure that we're supporting them. Many of them are continuing to work, but they have new challenges at home with kids at home and those kinds of things. We continue, again, virtual learning is also failing in a number of our communities. A lot of the school districts are really struggling, and we're trying to make sure that people have broadband and technological capacity in their households to be able to connect people, because we think that going into the fall, there's going to be more challenges around that. And we continue to be concerned about our undocumented population. So that's my story. I'm sticking to it. Thanks.
Thanks, Tom. Appreciate the work you're doing in the Valley. I have family that lives in Merced and friends that live in Fresno. So they all know you and know your great work. So thank you for taking the time with us this morning. We've reached the question portion of the panel presentation, and we do have one question for each panelist, and we got about 10 minutes left, so we're hoping we can run really quickly through these. But the first question is for Alicia, and Alicia, you mentioned that lenders currently were offering, if you will, several exotic products or different products in terms of helping families with this current pinch. Why do you think lenders are doing that, and why aren't they relying on traditional products like you noted, or mortgage forbearance or traditional refinance?
Opportunism. I mean, look at the looting. I think we've got an issue, but there's different factors driving each, right? Let me not paint with such a broad brush. I think for these lenders, the opportunity to try to extract a fee from whatever kind of workout they're doing is something that needs to be checked by the advocacy organizations like our own working with families. What we were hearing was that, our homeowner clients were being forced into products that they should have just been getting simple forbearances on their mortgage notes. And so, you know, in one instance, The lender was completely unresponsive to the requests of the borrower. We had to get political intervention. We had to call our local electeds to add pressure to that lender to track them, identify, you know, who they were regulated by, and add pressure for them to respond to this family. And when they finally did, it was just a forbearance letter that had to be executed. And so, you know, the sheer volume, I think, of these transactions requires, you know, and necessitates or pushes a lender, I think, to seek to use that as an opportunity for more business themselves. And I think if there is no regulation in place to prevent that, why not offer the consumer another product and the ability to extract another fee? I think it's just opportunism, unfortunately.
It's kind of scary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Alicia, for that clarification. Norma, the question for you is around the point you made about redefining income inequality. Given San Francisco, I would think you have a lot of reference points for how best to do so. But can you elaborate on the metrics or the eligibility criteria that would be considered for that new type of definition and whether you've identified a venue to try to move that policy or where are you in the formulation of that strategy?
Yeah, thank you for that question. So the idea here is to look at what makes someone vulnerable. And we think that once that is more clearly defined, and we can use the experience in the pandemic to help define that, that we can use that definition, those criteria, to develop a paradigm for sensitive communities that are deserving of certain considerations in policymaking and in resources. And so what we know about the pandemic is that vulnerable communities, at least in the San Francisco order, vulnerable communities have been identified as individuals who are 60 years of age or over, or individuals who have certain pre-existing health conditions. But what we have found with the experience on the ground, that there is, in essence, a per se vulnerability if you're Latino, if you earn less than $50,000, if you are an essential worker, and if you live in, if you're underhoused, either without housing or in crowded housing. So what we're trying to say is, let's redefine that. What does vulnerable look like? And when we're talking about disease response, remember that disease response is just, it's just a symbol of everything else that's wrong, right? And that it's actually fairly easy to identify the vulnerabilities if you look at inequities. And interestingly enough, when I was doing some research around, like, can we expand this definition of vulnerability, I found a document by the Center for Disease Control, which had identified socioeconomic factors as vulnerabilities. And I'm thinking, why has this not been factored into the public health orders regarding vulnerability? And should there be, and there must be, a greater preparation for these sorts of disasters, whether it's medical, whether it's economic? We can do this. Like, we should know what needs to be in place before the disaster hits. And so what this is about is looking at ways that we can redefine the moment so that we can shape the policies so that they are protective and responsive to the needs of our communities way before we have to do the cleanup. So it's not about mitigation. Let's fix what went wrong. It's like, let's not let it go wrong in the first place, right? So that's the concept. We are, we're in the middle of a sign-on letter that we started here in San Francisco amongst our coalition members. And it will go to San Francisco policymakers. And we're also reaching out to our brothers and sisters in the African American and Asian Pacific Islander community to join in, to be declared a vulnerable community. And once we're able to cement that, we can use that for policy purposes. So I hope I answered that question.
You're on mute.
I am on mute, my apologies. I was just noting, Norma, that it's exciting, right? And like all policy, you can get it done in one place, you can then try to export and see if it flies elsewhere. So good luck with that. Tom, Question for you. You noted undocumented families were right now one of the most challenged kind of aspects of your work, particularly given the public charge concern. How is self-help getting around those constraints? And what is the state or local governments doing to support? Is it working?
Yeah, so what we're trying to do is to, first of all, do outreach to those folks and have make sure that we're reaching out to those folks who are not taking advantage of some of the programs that are out there and trying to do what we can to alleviate any fears that they have. But that is daunting. So the other thing we're doing is trying to raise money to do some direct assistance to them and trying to focus on that as a priority. In terms of what the state is trying to do, while that was a gallant attempt to get some money to undocumented folks, it's so far been a pretty bad failure in terms of money getting out on the street. From what we're hearing, we're encouraging people to continue to try to connect for that. But in terms of the federal government is pretty much AWOL on this issue from as far as we're concerned.
Yeah. We all know what that's like, right? So appreciate Tom, the candid response. I think we're about 2 minutes left for this portion of the agenda. And I want to thank all the panelists for giving us such insightful and great content and information. So thank you, Alicia Matricardi from Economics for Women, Norma Garcia from MEDA, Mr. Tom Collishaw from Self-Help, for participating today. We do have a subsequent panel discussion this afternoon at 3:30. So for all of our affiliates, please, if you want to register for that, please go to our affiliate portal and be able to participate in what is a roundtable format that allows for this morning's conversation to basically transcend into a more affiliate discussion about what we do with this great contact and how it might inform any appropriate next steps. So thank you all for your time and look forward to seeing you all or hearing you all later this afternoon.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.